Welcome, everyone. I'm Tim Fry, the director of the Harriman Institute, and it's my great pleasure to introduce Michael McFaul, who will give the W. Averill Harriman Lecture for 2015. Just to give you some background, the Harriman Institute was founded in 1946 as the Russian Institute, and it's the oldest institute of its kind in the United States. In 1982, it was renamed in honor of W. Averill Harriman, former governor of New York, former ambassador to the Soviet Union, who made a generous gift to the Institute. And we're very thankful to the Harriman family for their continued financial support since then. The Averill Harriman Lectures were inaugurated in 1989 to honor the memory of W. Averill Harriman. And the idea here is to invite a speaker who makes a special intellectual contribution to the university community and to our field. Past Harriman Lectures have included leaders such as Mikhail Gorbachev and Helmut Schmidt, renowned academics like Barrington Moore, Dmitry Likachev, Catherine Verdery, Sergei Gurdjieff, and beloved writers like Andrei Sinyavsky, Imre Kertész, and Ismail Kadari. This year's lecture, A New Cold War, Russia's New Confrontation with the West, takes place at a particularly auspicious time in U.S.-Russian relations. It comes on the heels of the murder of Boris Nemtsov, the prominent activist at the walls of the Kremlin, and President Putin's mysterious 11 days disappearance from public view. It comes at a time of a tenuous ceasefire in eastern Ukraine that seems to be holding around the edges, but also amidst reports of a buildup on the Russian side of the border. It comes at a time when the U.S. and Europe are distracted by domestic political conflict and by other challenges abroad in the Middle East and in Iran. It also comes at a time when Russian nationalism is surging and the economy is stumbling badly. And few predict smooth sailing for Russia over the next few years. And we are really lucky tonight because few people are better suited to discuss these issues than our guest, Michael McFaul. I'm going to try to not slip into calling him Mike, because one of the things we all know about Mike
is that he's
His Excellency.
Come on, man.
Is that he's very obshitelny, so I refer to him as, and I've known Mike a long time since we studied together at the Putin Institute in 1985, so we go back a ways. Ambassador McFaul served for 5 years in the Obama administration, first as Special Assistant to the President and Senior Director for Russian and Eurasian Affairs to the National Security Council, and then, of course, as Ambassador from the U.S. to Moscow from 2012 to 2014. Among his other achievements, Ambassador McFaul played a key role in making sure that the New START Treaty was signed, that placed strict limits on nuclear weapons on both sides, played a key role in negotiating Russia's support for the U.S. war in Afghanistan, and also in gaining Moscow's cooperation on economic sanctions with Iran, a pretty impressive record. He also helped bring the diplomatic corps into the modern era with his more than 100,000 followers on Twitter, many of whom are Russian. But what makes Ambassador McFaul, so unique is not only his great policymaking experience, but also his great academic credentials. He has a PhD from Oxford, he became a Rhodes Scholar, and he also received tenure in the political science department at Stanford University, which he joined in 1995. And of course, his books on political change in Russia, on democratization, on Russian foreign policy, are real staples of syllabi on Russian politics and Russian foreign policy. He's currently professor of political science and director of Stanford University's Freeman Spogli Institute for International Affairs, a senior fellow at the Hoover Institution, and he also works as an analyst for NBC News. So as you can see, we're really lucky that he could find time in his very busy schedule to come and speak tonight. So we're really honored to have Ambassador Mike McFaul. And please join me in welcoming this year's lecturer, Ambassador Michael McFaul.
Thank you, Professor Fry. Thank you all for coming. It's a real honor to give this lecture, to give this talk. I passed Ambassador Harriman's photo every morning as I went down to have breakfast, and saw him every night as I went up to the residence quarters at Spasso House, if you've been there. It's a fantastic residence where the U.S. ambassador lives. And on the wall, walking up the staircase, is every ambassador since the restoration of relations or the inauguration of relations with the Soviets from 1933 now to me. So it's quite an impressive list, including Ambassador Harriman, Governor Harriman. So I'm glad to be here tonight. I'm especially glad to be back. I spoke here a long time ago when I was still an academic, and I'm somewhere between a recovering bureaucrat and an aspiring professor. And that's kind of the talk I'm going to give today. And let me make sure, I also don't have glasses, so I got, okay, I got a really small thing here. I think I can see it. It's really, really tiny, so I might have to look over here. But here's what I want to do. We have an audience, I can tell, just because I heard a lot of Russian as we were walking in. We have a pretty learned audience here. We have people here that know a lot about Russia and will want to ask all kinds of questions about the day-to-day, and I'm happy during the Q&A session to get into everything. I have ideas about a lot of things, and I'm curious to hear your ideas. But instead of that, I want to answer one big question tonight. And it came to me when I came home to Stanford, and my neighbor invited me over for lunch. And he said, you know, typical, how was it being ambassador? You know, tell us about the government. And we got to talking about the Putin era versus Medvedev. And my neighbor also had served in government, and he started to get nostalgic for when he dealt with the Soviets. And he started to go on about his counterparts. In fact, one of the lecturers, Mikhail Gorbachev, and the foreign minister that worked with him, Edward Shevardnadze. And his name's George Shultz, by the way, my neighbor. And George was talking about the end of the Cold War and about how these four gentlemen, in his view, Reagan himself, Gorbachev, and Shevardnadze, worked together to end this Cold War. And it was striking because for him, that was the end of history, right? That was the end of 20th century conflict with the Soviets. And as I left, I got on my bicycle. No longer do I have a one-speed Schwinn instead of my black limousine and bodyguards. I kept thinking, man, that era that George just described is actually over as well. In no matter how you pierce it, it's hard to think about what they started back then in some kind of continuous terms today. I also thought, why did he get so lucky? He got to deal with Gorbachev and Shevardnadze. You know who I had to deal with. And that got me thinking about, you know, the relationship between structural forces of change and individuals like my neighbor, George Shultz and Gorbachev, and what's the balance between them? And that's the kind of question I want to answer today. What happened, right? Why did we get to this? Tim already described a bit of this. I think it's fair to say you have to go pretty deep into the Cold War to remember a time that is so confrontational as we are in today, right? These kinds of things that, you know, on this slide, Russian intervention in the neighborhood, annexation of territory, you got to go way back to think about that. 83% of Russians now think of the United States as an enemy. And Putin, of course, describes the conflict in these zero-sum terms and really talks, I think, I would say, in ideological terms, not just about interests, but about the decadent West, the Imperial America, and the Nazis that we support in Ukraine. And likewise, on our side, you know, if you think about the president's speech at the UN General Assembly when he listed together Ebola, ISIS, and Russia. That didn't go down too well in Moscow, just so you know. Western sanctions. There's actually never been a time in history, even during the Cold War when the chief of staff of the Kremlin was on a sanction list. All these other things kicked him out of the G8, discussions of arming Ukraine. And likewise, Americans, I don't think it's quite up to 80%, but most Americans now think of Russia as an enemy again. So the one question I want to answer is just why? What happened? How did we go from George Shultz and those glory days that he was reminiscing about with me a year ago to where we're at today? And I want to go through three different big kinds of arguments, right? For the IR theorists in the room from 30 years ago, you'll see this is Ken Waltz, Man, the State, and War, kind of modified. Which is to go through this kind of structural argument about conflict, related to the balance of power, then talk about the United States, which is very popular these days for what we did to cause this conflict, but then the focus, and this is where I come out, on the Russian domestic story, right? So this is a kind of, if you remember, I talked about structure and agent. This is a continuum, and you're going to see, I'm going to build the argument. It's not white or black. It's not just individuals. But by the end, my bluff for the military folks in the room, bottom line up front, is that I actually do think this is a story about individuals. It's not a story about structures, although those are part of the story. The real punchline is going to be when I get to number one. All right, let's start with the structure of the international system. And I just want to remind you for a minute, if I can get this to go, that there is an argument that says what we see today in terms of Russia's behavior in Europe is exactly what we've seen for 1,000 years. I started this at 1,000, right? So now we're at 1198. And you can see here, as powers rise and fall, borders in Europe change rather dramatically, by the way, right? We're now at 1305, if you're trying to keep up. And I'm not going to run this all the way through, but Golden Horde still. Okay, we haven't even got to Muscovy yet. All right. You get the picture, right? This is a story of the rise and fall of different armies, powers, battling it out, and so borders change. And many people, therefore, especially in Moscow, by the way, argue that what we're witnessing today is just the continuation of that story. That is to say that Russia was weak 30 years ago. Russia's now recovered in terms of different measures of power, especially within its neighborhood. And therefore, what we see now is the natural correction to what happened back in 1991. And so Russia's just behaving like a great power, just like that's how great powers behave. Now, you can already tell by the tone of my voice, I don't accept this argument. But I do want to pause to say that this part of the story is a necessary condition for the full explanation. I mean, just think of the absurd counterfactual. If Russia had less power today than it did back in 1991, the probabilities of conflict that I described before would be less. And most certainly, you know, we don't care about, well, somebody in this room probably does. I was just going to say, we don't care about small, weak powers that don't have the capability to change the borders of their states. In fact, we care a lot about failed states. But the point is, without power, without the capability to do these things, we wouldn't be talking about the beginning of a new confrontational phase with Russia. So it's a piece of the story, but I don't think it's the whole story. And that is because I can think of other cases of rising powers that don't invade their neighbors, that don't annex territory from their neighbors. Poland and Germany, Japan and Germany after World War II, think of Poland today. You can think of a lot of other examples where this is not a necessary, inevitable foreign policy posture of a rising state. We're having the debate about China today. Is it inevitable or not? I don't think it's inevitable. I think you have to add other pieces to the story to understand why some states behave that way with more power and others don't. If I had more time, I would play around with this counterfactual. The second one, what about the rise of a democratic Russia? That seems so absurd to talk about these days that it's not that interesting. But I was one of those who believed in a democratic Russia 20, 30 years ago, who believed that it was a possibility. And if you played out that it, just for 30 seconds, imagine for 30 seconds that democratic institutions consolidated in Russia after the collapse of the Soviet Union. I think it's a reasonable hypothetical assumption to think that the conflict we're seeing today would at least be less likely, and I think it actually would not have happened. But that's too much counterfactual. That's too much for today. So let me just tell you about reality right before Putin decided to go in to Crimea and then eastern Ukraine. Does anybody here, now this is a scary audience to ask this. Does anybody remember Putin's speech about the necessity of bringing in Russians from Crimea into the Russian Federation. Tell me when he gave that speech. Ah, so it really is a learned class, because usually I say that somebody raises their hand and they talk about some speech in Munich or something like that. You actually know your history because you know that he didn't give that speech before 2014, right? That wasn't what he was focused on. In fact, when we were reporting about Russian foreign policy when I was still ambassador in Moscow, I would have said to you, and we did say in our reporting, that the number one foreign policy objective for Putin as he came into power again in 2012 was the creation of the Eurasian Economic Union. Now, most people, actually, this is a weird audience again. Most of you have probably heard of it. Most Americans had never heard about it because there wasn't much reporting about it. There wasn't much attention to it. But this was Putin's response to the EU. Whether it was coercive or collaborative, we can talk about in questions, but this was what he wanted to do. Belarus, Kazakhstan, and Ukraine. Not just the Crimeans, but all of Ukraine. Why? Because colleagues of mine were in charge of this, Russian colleagues of mine, they rightly believed that to make this thing work as a viable economic entity, they needed the 45 million Ukrainians to be a part of it, not just these smaller pieces. The drama was all about getting Ukraine in, right? So much so that Putin put on the table $15 billion to President Yanukovych so that he wouldn't sign an agreement with the EU. Other things, just to remind you, right before he went into Crimea, there were not that many indications of the necessity of recreating the Russian Empire or righting the wrongs of 1991. And I could give you many examples, but two really jumped out at me as I was living this in real time. One, he let out of jail Mikhail Khodorkovsky, the billionaire who spent 10 years in jail. I was at the Kremlin a couple weeks after that, seeing a very senior Russian official that worked for Putin. I asked him, why now? And he said, this is because we want to get things back on track with you guys. This was for you. All right, that's just a data point, right? And the other one, I'll skip the other folks released from jail because I never like to say those words, especially when somebody's taping me and photographing me. But the other one was this incredible party that Putin threw. $50 billion, allegedly, he spent. Was anybody there, by chance, with me? Sochi? So you were there? What were you doing there, if it's not a secret? Oh, so was I. Maybe we were there together. It was a pretty great party. Now criticized, you know, all these kind of things, but that, you know, my perception, I was there, I went twice, right? My perception of this was a coming out party for the new Russia, right? There were all these kids is not a nice word, there were all these students, college age students and younger in these really colorful outfits, being really friendly. Including with me, by the way, this monster portrayed on public television. We're going to get to that in a minute. You're going to see that. But it was this atmosphere that this is the new Russia. This is not the Russia of the 1980 Olympics. And that was definitely the messaging in the opening and closing ceremonies. And one episode of the closing ceremony really struck out at me, sitting with my colleagues. If you remember, they had this one skit episode where they strolled across the field sketches and portraits of Russian authors, and then they flipped them up. You remember that? So by the way, parenthetically, you got to have a lot of chutzpah to do that with the whole world watching. I'm not sure America has 50 authors we could flip up and people would know who they are, right? So it tells you a little bit. I mean, it was pretty cool just from that point of view. And in the stadium, people recognized them and cheered. Two, though, jumped out at me. Solzhenitsyn and Brodsky. That was the new Russia, right? This is not a return to the Cold War. The message was, this is our new history. They had a skit about the Soviet period, too, by the way. It was rather jarring. But that was really different. And suggesting that this was to say we are on the stage as a respected member of the international system, not challenging it. So what happened? There's got to be more to the story if that stuff is happening. Second, U.S. policy. This comes in two forms, But the punchline in both forms is that we're responsible, right? Muy vinovate. This is our problem. We created this. The first one, which is more worthy of talking about, is that we pushed too hard on the Russians. You know, we told them to build markets. Actually, Tim Fry was doing this, for Christ's sake. You know, it's his fault. Professor Fry is at fault, right? He's over there preaching markets and telling them that they had to build democracy and this stuff. And then we expanded NATO. Then we bombed Serbia. We invaded Iraq. We supported counter-revolutions, orange revolutions, color revolutions on their borders. And so Putin had no response but to push back, right? So, again, that is part of the narrative. And I want to make sure you understand that this is a part of the explanation, and most certainly post facto, it's part of the explanation for Putin. But I also think it's part of the historical narrative as well. And in fact, this is a quote I wrote, my first op-ed piece ever, by the way. Regretfully, no disrespect to the San Jose Mercury News, but regretfully in the San Jose Mercury News, because nobody read it. But they did give me 5,000 words, I believe. And I just talked about thinking about the blowback that we would see. This, by the way, is a year before the collapse of the Soviet Union. And I just put it up there as a kind of confession that I, too, was worried that there was going to be this blowback and that we weren't going to see this for all that it was. And then there was going to be this return, the Thermidor, to stretch the analogy. Here I was comparing the French Revolution, the Bolshevik Revolution, and what I was calling the Soviet Revolution. And I feared that there was going to be a Napoleon or Stalin figure that would come back to haunt us. And tragically, I think that was true. So I think it's part of the narrative, right? That is, there was some of that visceral stuff, reaction, and most certainly it plays into the propaganda to explain the situation today. But you've got to explain some history that came after all that stuff. And that's the history when I was in the government. We called it the reset, for better for ill. But our basic argument is this, that when we came into government in January of 2009, we thought that there were interests that did overlap with the Russians, and that through engagement with them, we could realize our national interests in a more efficient way than if we just did it alone. Interests were not zero-sum, in our view, that could be good for the Russians, good for us, and we thought we could also manage difficult issues through this new approach. That, by the way, is my first day in the Oval Office. It's the president's third day in the Oval Office. He's about to call Medvedev for the first time. Afterwards, one of the guards told me I'm not supposed to touch the desk. I don't know if that's true, but he shook me up when he told me that. So Tim's already graciously mentioned some of the things, but we got a bunch of things done, right? This is the president's signing the New START Treaty in Prague in 2010. We got that done. We developed the Northern Distribution Network, which was a supply route that when we came into office was 2 to 3% of our supplies into Afghanistan. By the time I left government, it was over 50%. And this proved to be vital because the southern route went through Pakistan. And as you will recall, we did some pretty extraterritorial things in Pakistan during the first term of the Obama administration, including attack against Osama bin Laden. Had 95% of our supplies gone through Pakistan at that time, that would have been a much tougher call. Third, we did sanctions. Tim's already mentioned it. Again, most comprehensive sanctions ever. Fourth, we managed difficult things. You probably don't even remember the revolution, the regime change that happened in 2010, but hundreds of people died. 300,000 people left Kyrgyzstan at that time. And I'll tell you, for me personally, it was the scariest couple of weeks of my time in government. I was working at the White House at the time, and I thought we were on the verge of a genocide. That's what it felt like. By the way, across the hall from me sat Samantha Power, who had written a book about how we have to prevent genocide. But most of you, again, this is a weird group. When I gave this lecture in Montana, and I said, had anybody heard of this? Nobody had. And you, even I'll bet you a lot of people here didn't hear about it because it was an event that kind of happened but did not become the giant crisis that the Ukrainian crisis has become. Because then Putin, Medvedev called Obama. Then we decided that it was in neither of our two countries' interests to have a genocidal war in Kyrgyzstan. And we worked together to try to defuse this, I think, in a rather successful way. All of these things I want to point out before I move on to some other lesser results. These are not little mamby-pamby, you know, let's have a working group on innovation. No disrespect to the working group on innovation. I invented it. These are really big things that matter to American national security, right? And on all four of these, the Russians were with us, not against us, in the first years of the reset. I'll skip these lesser ones. Remind you, this is just 3 years ago. These are Russian soldiers training with American soldiers in Colorado on anti-terrorist activities. Economic results, there's my former governor. For you Russians, there's your former president visiting Cisco. That was in 2010. We got a bunch of stuff done here. We got them into the WTO, PNTR. We raised trade. We got a new visa regime. You know, we could have done better, but the trend lines were going in the right direction. More Russians, as a result of this, were coming to the United States. And more Russians had a favorable view of the United States. It peaks around 60%. There are other polls that show it more like at 65. But that was just 4 years ago. 4 years ago. We can skip this. By the way, same on the American side. We got up to 60% on the American side. All of that happened after NATO expansion. All of that happened after the Iraq War. All of that happened after the Orange Revolution in Ukraine in 2004. So you've got to be able to explain all of that, and to do so, I think you need more variables than just these that said it was all about American aggressive policy towards Russia. That was just 3 or 4 years ago. One last one, quickly. The other argument, of course, is this is all our fault because we weren't too strong, not because we were too strong, but because we were too weak. Obama's weak, reset created the permissive conditions for Russian aggression. We didn't deter Putin soon enough, and you know, this is what you get. In fact, here's what our speaker said. Maybe you can't all read that, so I'll read it to you. When you look at this chaos that's going on, does anybody think that Vladimir Putin would have gone into Crimea had George W. Bush been president of the United States? No! Even Putin is smart enough to know that Bush would have punched him in the nose in about 10 seconds. That's Speaker Boehner. Now, let's cut him some slack. Note the date. This is 10 days before the election. People say some things, they get a little wound up before elections, so we should, you know, remind yourselves. But that's an argument you hear, and I would just say a couple of things on this. One, there was pushback, and we can talk about that maybe in questions, but I think this other piece is more important, which is to say that every time Russian leaders since World War II have thought about using force in Eastern Europe, they've thought about the risk, cost, and benefit analysis. In fact, I've imagined this. We used to do this when I was at the White House, and there would be a question about Iran or North Korea or Afghanistan, and the question would be, well, what are the Russians going to do? And so that's when, you know, Mike, what are the Russians going to do? So there's got to be, in fact, I think I know who it is. There's got to be somebody just like that who works for Putin. And Ivan Ivanovich, let's call him Ivan Ivanovich. Ivan Ivanovich, what are the Americans going to do? And in every one of these cases, you know, going back to 56, 68, 81, 2008, when George W. Bush actually happened to be president, the answer's always clear. There's not going to be a military response. There's not going to be a coercive military response. That's true, Democrats or Republicans in power. By the way, to provoke you, what's more interesting for a longer conversation is the response afterwards in terms of how coercive it is. And I would posit to you that the Obama response is a lot more like Ronald Reagan's response in 1981 than of any of the other presidents listed here. And maybe in questions, because that's got to be provocative. Reagan and Obama don't get compared too often. I think that's true, but let's talk about that in question. So let's finally get to what I think is the punchline for why we're in the mess we are in today, and that has to do mostly, those other things are important part of the story, but mostly with domestic politics inside of Russia. And two big events I think are critical to understanding this story. First, there are others, but in the interest of time, let me just focus on two right now. First, the change from Medvedev to Putin. So to remind you, in September of 2011, President Putin announced that he was going, Prime Minister Putin, excuse me, announced that he was going to run for president a third time, and Putin decided, you know, they're going to do their little switcheroo-y thing, and he's going to play prime minister for a while. I'll tell you honestly, I was still working at the National Security Council. I at the time, I don't want to invoke other people, thought that this was not going to be as big a change in terms of policy as we later learned. In fact, I remember very vividly the day we were in to see the president about another matter, and he grabbed my arm. It was like 2 days after this, and he pulled me in. He said, "What do you think?" And I said, "Well, it's unfortunate that the guy that you've developed this relationship with, President Medvedev, is going to now have a different job. But remember, we've always assumed that Putin has been in charge of foreign policy this whole time. He's the big dog. You know, Medvedev's just the marionette. And so we should expect continuity in terms of foreign policy." By the way, that's the message that all senior Russian leaders were also giving us at the time, including then President Medvedev. That turned out not to be true. It turned out that Medvedev and Putin are quite different in their foreign policy orientation, and I would actually say about a lot of other things, and that already before, it was already clear, even in those early period, that Putin just had a different kind of way of looking at world politics. He defined things in zero-sum terms with us. He didn't accept this win-win language that Obama and Medvedev love to talk about. He defined the United States fundamentally as a competitor, not a partner. And most troubling, and then it became very difficult as a result of this worldview, Putin assigns an incredible amount of power to the CIA. The CIA, by the way, has a lot of power, but not nearly as much as Mr. Putin, President Putin, thinks. And he believes that, we use that kind of coercive power, by the Pentagon as well, but he's really focused on the CIA, that we go out and we foment regime change all over the world. Now, again, it's important to point out that, you know, the hypothesis has a lot of empirical data to support it. Historically, the United States, from time to time, has used coercive power, overt and covert, to overthrow regimes. It was not the case in the Obama era, but that wasn't Putin's view. He assigned to us, especially during the Arab Spring, later in Russia and later in Ukraine, this kind of power, and that kind of analytic contradiction we had about the nature of American power proved to be insurmountable in terms of dealing with Putin. But then the second thing happened. In between September of 2011 and the spring, March 2012, when the elections the presidential elections happened, there was a parliamentary election. And I don't know, actually I should ask Professor Fry what he thought at the time. But at the time, when we were sitting there with our electoral experts in the embassy and our colleagues in the city, you know, there was fraud, but it was kind of your generic, normal kind of level of fraud that we'd seen for the last 20 years. You know, not too much, not too little, kind of generic, normal. That was our assessment. But there were some folks that also saw that fraud, but they had a different reaction to it in this election than the previous ones. First of all, they could document it better because of technology, because of smartphones, VKontakte, And some of them are sitting here, so I feel a little awkward talking about it in front of them. This is our view from the embassy, okay? And so that accelerated the information. But then they got pissed off, and they said, we're not going to just let normal fraud happen anymore. We're going to do something about it, and that's what happened in that period. Before I became ambassador, I want to point that out, that happened all before I arrived in Moscow. This is Bolotnaya. And that precipitated a big debate in the Kremlin, what to do about these people. And I want to stress, two things. One, just to go through, well, let me go through this first. For Putin, I sense two reactions. Well, a couple of times I even heard him talk about it himself. First, he was pissed. He's like, I made those people rich. I'm the one that made them, you know, with all their fancy cars and their houses and their travels to Europe, and now they're turning on me. Now, I think oil and gas prices might have a little something to do with it, and I've written about that elsewhere. That was not his view. He's like pissed off. He's like, why don't they love me? Why don't they support me? I'm the one that made Russia in this growth period. But then the second reaction was fear, real fear. Remember, this is 2011. This is in the wake of the Arab Spring. This is in the wake of Egypt and Syria and all that stuff is happening. And therefore, his reaction to that was to crack down, was to make them the enemy, to call them the enemy, and to use us, the United States, as part of that argument, that we were the ones that was doing this to Russia. And I've been talking, I won't read these quotes. I picked this one out especially for some of the folks in the audience. Navalny was my product, right? I created Navalny. He was my guy. Me and a former Harriman lecturer, by the way, Mikhail Gorbachev. That's a nice company to be in. But this was the theme of Putin's reaction to these demonstrations. They're the enemy, and we're supporting the enemy. This is a calendar, by the way, that they put out in English and Russian, and all the different months are different opposition leaders. Here's another one that will be familiar to some of you in the audience. This is a poster they put up on the 6th of May. The political circus is back on the stage, and there you see I am. I can't read that. I think it says I'm the artistic director with all of these other opposition leaders. Here I am campaigning for Navalny. That's Photoshop, just to be clear. I do not have those kind of, I wish I had big hands like that. I play basketball, but I don't have big hands as that. And I just wanted you just to remember, just a feel for, whoops, if I can do this one. Even if you don't speak Russian, you'll get a sense, this is kind of...
Страсти по Макфолу. В российской оппозиции паника. Увольняют посла США в России Майкла Макфола. Информированные источники из внешнеполитического ведомства сообщили прессе, что последним мероприятием посла, скорее всего, станет день 80-летия установления дипломатических отношений России и США, 16 ноября. Назначение Макфола в 2011 году стало настоящим праздником для российской несистемной оппозиции. В США он имел репутацию выдающегося специалиста по так называемым «цветным революциям». Сразу после прибытия Макфола в Москву резко активизировалась деятельность так называемого «протестного движения». Маргиналы из карликовых организаций, от анархистов до откровенных нацистов, стали
выходить... This is now every day the way we are being portrayed. This one is most dramatic. This is just from a couple months ago, Mr. Kisilov's show, where he compares the ideology of the ISIS leader here, Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, to Barack Obama. Basically saying, we could go through it. A lot of people here read Russian, so I don't need to. But basically saying, they're a little bit different, but basically Barack Hussein Obama, if you watch the video, he really accents that. They basically have the same worldview. So the last thing I want to say on this, and I'll conclude, I will conclude. This choice was not inevitable, in my view, right? Putin's choice, his reaction to these events, was not preordained by some structural variables or US foreign policy. And in fact, although, you know, I feel somewhat uneasy arguing this too vehemently because Medvedev is also part of the system today, but the initial reaction from President Medvedev was different than Putin's. This is a meeting of the opposition with Medvedev out at his dacha. By the way, you can see Boris Nemtsov is at the table as well. I actually ran into these guys as they were coming in to see Medvedev that day. There's lots of, you know, writing about that I supported the opposition. I met with them all the time. In fact, as a group, I had never met them ever. This is the first and last time I ever met them together, as they were coming out into President Medvedev's dacha. And what's interesting about this is that Medvedev was seeking a different way to deal with these kind of protests. Elections for governors, talk about the new electoral law, promise of a public television, obviously none of that came through. But this is a critical part of my argument because it suggests that this wasn't preordained by these structural things, but this was a Putin's choice. And yet, and then I'm going to end here quickly, even after all this drama, I want to convey to you that during this 2 years that I was ambassador, there was these dual impulses that we saw from Putin all the time. On the one hand, we're the enemy. On the other hand, on certain issues, not all, most certainly not the ambitious agenda that we had with President Medvedev, he wanted to cooperate. I remember very vividly one meeting we had with him. He went on a tirade for 20 minutes about all the damage we're doing in supporting revolutionaries in the Middle East. And then 30 seconds later, he talked about the Rosneft ExxonMobil deal as being the most important event in U.S.-Russian relations in 30 years. He was good at compartmentalizing. By the way, he didn't have to worry about the contradictions in terms of the media like our folks do, because he didn't have to be accountable when he was doing that. And I think that's important to remember that even through 2012, 2013, we saw this dual nature of Putin. And then there was the final straw that, of course, broke the camel's back, which were the fall of the government in Kiev. Now, again, I want to make clear, in case it's not clear in this audience, we did not push Yanukovych out of power. We did not have a strategy of regime change in Ukraine. Some young Ukrainians did, by the way. To our surprise, we were surprised just as much as Yanukovych was in their reaction to him not signing the EU agreement. And we tried desperately hard to cut a deal between Yanukovych and the opposition. I think the vice president called Yanukovych a dozen times during this period to get him to sign up. Likewise, we worked with the Ukrainian opposition leaders to try to pact a transition to avoid the total meltdown of the regime. That was our policy. And we were quite excited when they initialed this deal on February 21st. I remember, I was in Sochi at the time. We thought we had avoided the worst case scenarios in Ukraine. And 12 or 24 hours, depending on how you count, Yanukovych showed up in Rostov and the deal was over. He had left. We were confused, I'll tell you honestly. I mean, what's going on? Why Rostov? Why didn't he stay? And these other, he was bouncing around this the country, if you may remember. Putin was not confused, or at least publicly, he was very clear. This, for him, was yet another instance of us fomenting regime change, double-crossing them. And that's when I think, that's when this compartmentalization thing that I was talking about was over. And he decided right then and there that he's in a conflict with us for the rest of his time in power. So I have a longer implications thing that I think we'll just do. We'll just let it kind of spill out in questions. But just let me end on this. Good news, bad news. So the good news, if you accept my story, is there is no master plan to recreate the Russian Empire. Putin hasn't been staring at some map that he drew when he was 12 years old saying, if only I get into power, this is what I'm going to do. My story is one about an individual being tactical and emotional in a particular political moment. And if you think about counterfactuals, you play it back, and if some of these events I just described do not happen, the conflict doesn't happen. At least that's my argument. More good news is, therefore, is that more annexation is not inevitable, and most certainly for me, the most important piece of good news is that those structural big explanations are not true. We're not destined because of history or the balance of power in the international system or because of some mistakes in U.S. foreign policy from 20 or 30 years ago to be in conflict with Russia for decades to come. The bad news is I don't think the basic orientation of Russian foreign policy will change while Putin's in power. His end of his second term is 2014. He works out, allegedly, 3 hours a day. And he's even hinted about why he might think about staying on beyond that. So I actually think, in terms of his posture, it's pretty clear, and he's dug in. I have more question marks about whether our posture is clear and whether we're dug in, but I think I'll save those for questions. Thank you all.
Great job mixing the kind of personal and the analytical for a really entertaining talk. We've got about 40 minutes for questions, so you can tell that Mike is not a pure academic yet because he still had a lot more time to talk, and any academic would never leave that much time on the table.
That. So I forgot my watch. I didn't know. Okay.
So if we could ask people to come to the microphone, please tell us who you are and state your question really in the form of a question rather than in a form of a long pronouncement. While people are gearing up, let me ask you one question that you haven't talked very much about is the state of the Russian economy. One way to tell the story is that we had a long period of economic growth that really burnished President Putin's support. And now we're entering a period where the economy is stumbling badly. And might that not be a source of change in Russian foreign policy? And one could imagine it going either way. It could be a source for a more aggressive foreign policy or for one that's less confrontational. So do you have any thoughts on that?
So a couple of thoughts, although I don't actually know how it plays. I think you're right. It can play in two very different ways, and I don't have a clear view on it. But I would add, just to build the story about this Putin pivot, that the absence of an economic growth story was part of his frustration in 2012, mm-hmm. 2013. He was stuck at an approval rating of like at 45% through that whole period. And even this anti-Americanism stuff, which, you know, it's hard to measure, and different people have different readings of how much it played. I remember one senior Kremlin person after the election telling me, Mike, first of all, no hard feelings, right? All this stuff. One time I was even accused of being a pedophile in a video thing. So it's kind of hard not to have a hard feeling about that. But he's like, you know, this was just all for the election. And we believe this is, I don't want to name him because we're on the record, but a very senior guy in the campaign. They thought they picked up 15 points in the election in March. But it dissipated pretty quickly. It dissipated. And so they were stuck. And most certainly, the opportunity to have a new argument with the annexation of Crimea and this battle against Nazis in the decadent West, I think, was appealing to Putin. And most certainly, you know, we were talking earlier. My guess is that his approval rating is not as high as it's reported publicly, but it's most certainly got an uptick because of this action. And it's a new argument now that is important for his argument for legitimacy. The problem for him, and this gets me to your question, the problem is if you define us as Nazis, if you define us, the West, as evil, and that's your basic argument for why you need to keep people in this kind of war mentality, fighting this war, it's hard the next day to pivot and say, okay, you know, now we're going to sit down with Hitler. We're going to sit down with the devil, and we're going to negotiate something. And I think that's a big problem for him. I think it will undermine his argument to pivot too quickly from that. Unless, of course, he can declare victory, but that, I think, is hard for him. With respect to the, you know, the data about the economy that, that Tim, you know as well as I do, everybody does, we know where the trends are. We have a basic kind of understanding about how much of it is caused by falling oil prices and how much of it is caused by sanctions. I think the sanctions are a much smaller portion of it. What I can't predict with any certainty is when does that lead to pressure on Putin? I was part of this with Iran, right? It's exactly the same arguments we had in 2010 when we pivoted to sanctions on Iran. And Iran was a much weaker economy, much more vulnerable to these kinds of sanctions. And yet it took several years before there was, I would say, pretty clear-cut information that the sanctions were having this political effect internally. And the other thing you got to remember about sanctions in Iran is they actually had an election in between this time. Not a free and fair one, doesn't meet Freedom House standards, but it was competitive. And Rouhani, the current president, ran on, in part to lift sanctions and this rapprochement that we're now seeing. I don't see that scenario in Russia anytime soon, right? Those kind of weak democratic or pluralistic institutions that we witnessed in Iran, I would argue, are weaker in Russia today. And therefore, the feedback effect is harder to trace. And then just the last thing I think is frequently misunderstood by folks in America. We talk about the oligarchs and the rich folks, right? Who, you know, some of them are folks I know well, and some of them have lost billions of dollars. That's true, because of sanctions and because of falling oil prices. And so you put that in the American mindset, and you would think, well, these are the rich guys. They support. They're all guys, by the way. They support Putin, and so they should be arguing to Putin that he should do this, that, and the other. But they forget that most of them, not all of them, are rich because of Putin, not the other way around. And therefore, the influence between Putin and the Kremlin and those folks go in the opposite direction that I think people sometimes anticipate or expect in a more capitalistic system.
Great, thanks.
Hi. First, just thank you, Ambassador McFaul. This has been really fascinating. I'm David Kleon. I'm an editor at World Politics Review. I wanted to ask you a little bit about Medvedev. So you said earlier that while you were advising the Obama administration, he was perceived as, I think you said, a marionette. And, I would say the convention...
To громко сказано. Let me take the edge off of that. Yeah, I said that, but now let me rephrase that, as we would say in the government.
I wanted to say, so you... And I think the conventional wisdom on him now, I mean, just kind of in the media... is that he was a placeholder, one-term president before, so Putin could stay within the letter of the Constitution. At the same time, you pursued this very ambitious reset plan that you detailed with him and made some tangible policy objectives. And so I guess the two questions I have for you are, one, if you could just clarify, in retrospect, how much power you actually think Medvedev had during that period, and then also why did Putin, as a placeholder, choose someone who apparently had a more liberal profile? And relatedly, why didn't he just let him run again? Why did he throw him out unceremoniously and reverse all this? What do you think accounts for this bizarre Medvedev semi-presidency?
So, great questions. I won't have great answers, but let me give you to the best of my knowledge, right? So, on the first one about how much power... Remember, by the Russian Constitution, the president does foreign policy, and there's a division of labor there. And we always poo-pooed that, and we always thought Putin was making all the calls. And that's the part, I would say, that we got wrong in retrospect. In fact, we had one strange phone call that I was the... it was my idea... Because to call Putin to talk about foreign policy. So remember, just another piece of diplomacy, right? A lot of times we're criticized, why did you focus so much on Medvedev and not Putin, right? Well, it's because he was the president. And by protocol, he's in charge of foreign policy. And so to go around him and to engage Putin directly, neither of those two gentlemen wanted that to happen. One day we called him The president called, not me, he wouldn't take my phone calls. The president called him because we called him on something that he was expert on, the Olympics. And we were bidding for the Olympics, Chicago, 2012. It was a disaster, by the way, complete disaster. I think we came in fourth out of four. So we were looking for all kinds of angles, and Putin knows a lot about the Olympic Committee, successfully won a bid for Sochi. And so my idea was, let's call him and talk about that, and then let's talk about, you know, other things, Iran in particular. And so we called him, and they had a great chat about Olympics. Man, Putin loves the Olympics. And he did know that committee. He knew them by name, and then he did deliver the bad news. You have no chance at all, Mr. President. The Brazilians have it locked up. And then the president kind of said, oh, by the way, you know, this Iran thing, I just wanted to get your views. Very kind of softball kind of intro question. And he said, well, Barack, I don't do foreign policy anymore. I've got these other headaches I have to deal with. But I happen to be sitting next to the president right now. We're having lunch. It was 5 o'clock in the afternoon. And let me give you, I'll put him on the line. And that's what they did.
Wow.
And that was a signal to us, don't do this, right? And so that's the part about the Putin part. Now, back to Medvedev. Medvedev wanted to be president again. There's no doubt in my mind. I saw him many times in the run-up to September 2011. And he had to win one vote, right? To be reelected, he had to win one vote. So he had a strategy to win that vote. And that strategy was to be the good face, the guy that dealt with the West in ways that would be good for Russia as a whole, including to Prime Minister Putin. That was his argument. That was his campaign strategy. He experimented with some other things, by the way, but none of those were going to win Putin's one vote. That was his strategy. And by the end of his term, I mean, I should think about this more before I say it so definitively, but you know, if you think about what were his accomplishments as president, you know, the reset probably ranks at, if not the top, but at very high. So he was leaning in to try to make that work so that he could demonstrate to his one voter his, you know, necessity to be on the ticket, if you will, to stretch the metaphor, right? And I think in the end, he went too far. And that gets me to the second part. I don't obviously have no knowledge about what Putin was really thinking, right? Maybe this was all a ruse he was always planning to do. I don't know that. I do know lots of people around Putin, and most certainly the prime minister, who had a different perception. Maybe it was a false impression, but had a different perception all the way up until the night before the big Congress when they announced it. What I do think, in retrospect, if he was considering maintaining the status quo, Putin, I think a pivotal moment that proved very detrimental to Medvedev was his decision to abstain on the Security Council resolutions authorizing force against Libya. We lobbied hard for that, right? I was part of the team that did that. I remember when we obtained his acquiescence to abstain, right? Using kind of, he wasn't for it, but he could have blocked it, and he didn't. That was a huge diplomatic breakthrough for us. In fact, we overreacted. We thought, oh, well, we got him on Libya. Now it'll be, you know, doing it on Syria will be a piece of cake. We got too giddy with success. But I think that was the beginning where, in fact, Putin publicly criticized Medvedev for the first time. And I think that's when he probably decided this guy's a little too weak in terms of dealing with us.
Thank you.
Thanks. Peter Zalmayev, Eurasia Democracy Initiative Ambassador. I want to refer you to the recent theory by the Polish, former Polish president and leader of Solidarność, Lech Walesa, who said that he believes Russia, there will never be a flowering genuine flowering of democracy in Russia until that country disintegrates in along ethnic lines. That you know, in its current borders, Russia remains essentially an imperial entity, and so you know, it's comprised of 60 nationalities plus. So unless you know Russia sort of you know, withdraws into this core of 20 to 30 million ethnic Russians, that's the only scenario under which we can see a genuine democracy take hold in Russia. What is your opinion of that?
So I saw his comments, and I deeply respect him and what he did to make a lot of the history I was talking about earlier to happen. I don't think that's a necessary condition for democracy in Russia. I also don't think genuine democracy, however defined, is easy in multi-ethnic states like you described. The comparative literature on this shows that very clearly, but it's also not impossible. Big federal states like India, have managed to do it. Actually, it's a pretty mixed, I'm thinking of the other big federal states that are struggling with it. Nigeria comes to mind. It's hard. I want to be clear about that, but I don't think it's inevitable. And partly I make that argument because I saw the possibilities of it at an earlier period in Russian history. So I don't think it's inevitable, but it will be a very difficult road. I agree with that. The general assessment, because of the multi-ethnic nature, that it will be hard to build democratic institutions. I agree with that assessment, but not impossible.
Mr. McFaul, thank you for a great presentation. My name is Maria Snigovaya. I'm a PhD student here and also a columnist covering Russia-Ukraine conflict along with your lines. So I have two questions, one academic one and one journalistic one. So first of all, you're a prominent author on democratic transitions. Did you experience in Russia change anything in your perception? How would you rewrite your book based on your experience in Russia, first? And the second one would be like journalistic question. Why do you think Russians did this to you? Because it's known that you've been literally tortured by Russian Nazi movement, for example, unlike any other ambassador in the Russian history, including current ambassador, John Taft, who is actually known for serving in Georgia and Ukraine. So if Russians were against the U.S., you would expect them to be torturing him as well. So why you? Thank you.
I'm not sure I know how to answer the second question. So on the academic question, you're referring to this book I wrote a long time ago, right, in 2001. What I would say in retrospect now, knowing where we're at, I mean, remember in retrospect, well before, I was worried about the scenario now as well, right? That quote I quoted from 1990 was this Thermidor and the man on the white horse and the strong man that deals with the chaos and brings law and order. That's a phenomenon I've always been worried about. I want to make that clear. The book you're referring to, I think the piece that I didn't get right was, by the way, just in my defense, that whole book has a whole chapter 12, I think, of all the qualifications why this is likely to not consolidate in a democratic way, right? But I think the resilience of the Soviet era institutions, I was underestimating. That's the piece that I... if I think about my own analysis, that's what I underestimated. I mean, if you think about the people in power today, they're all, not all of them, but a lot of them come from certain institutions created in the Soviet era that were not reformed, that were not broken apart, that were not, transformed. And I remember the debate back in 1991, 92, in that era, when this was being debated among the, so-called, the Democrats, I want to be neutral whether they're Democrats or not, but those that themselves described themselves as Democrats, these were people I knew well. And there was one view as, we got them now, let's crush them now, because if we don't crush them now, they'll come back to haunt us. And there was another view that said, and this was definitely Boris Yeltsin's view, that if we try to crush them now, we'll trigger the Thermidor, the restoration, in a much faster way. So we need to co-opt them. We need to treat them, to bring them in, not to defang them and to arrest them. I mean, some people wanted to arrest them, right? For some people back then, the KGB was a criminal organization. and therefore should go on trial and be treated as criminals. That's not what they ultimately decided. They decided on this co-option. They did some things. I mean, they broke it up, and you know, the FSB and SVR, and but that, I think, in retrospect, just I personally underestimated the resilience of those institutions. On your second question, you know, I think the main point, it just reflects on how paranoid the regime was at that period. I just, you know, I used to ask my Russian friends in the government, like, and actually I even asked Putin one time, I mean, do you really believe that I have all these powers that you assigned to me? Like, come on, man. You know, it's like, first of all, you have 6,000 agents following me everywhere. Surely you would know if we were, you know, giving millions of dollars to Navalny, right? I mean, it's like I kind of played on their own. You guys are pretty good at this, right? You should be able to trace this stuff, right? But I do think it reflects a paranoia that was really, it's less today, right? It's less today. And therefore, they feel much more confident. But the other thing I got to say, honestly, and I'm struggling with this as I write about it, and so I reserve the right with all the cameras on to change my views as I digest this, because I'm in the process of digestion. So on the one point, like, come on, you know, we're not fomenting revolution. That's not what this the Obama administration was about. Others maybe did, right? They did. We did not. We would argue about that. The president would argue about that with Putin. And so on that point, it's kind of silly. At a deeper level, however, standing up for democratic values, talking about it, as I did, was threatening to the regime. That was an alternative way to think about organizing their government. And one really close friend of mine who would not want to be named right now, used to work in the government, he said, you know what, Mike? You know why they hate you so much? They hate you because you criticize them for these anti-democratic things you do, but you love Russia. And that drives them nuts. You know, if you could just be a cold warrior, it'd be easier. If you could just, you know, hate Russians and hate, you know, everything, it would be so much easier. And that messaging, which, you know, that's basically who I am. And that I am, by the way, open and talk like I'm talking right now and not like a traditional diplomat, and was on Twitter, you know, follow me, Subbotchka McFaul. I'm still active there. And that I was engaging and outspoken. That all was part of that piece. And so if I'm really honest with myself, you can see I don't really like to say it that way, but I think if I'm really honest, that was part of what my particular personality and the particular time that I was there brought. And remember that time thing, just one last thing, because big misconception, including that propaganda clip I just played, that I was sent to Russia to foment revolution, right? And so Bolotnaya happened, and then, you know, they flew me in on that jet, and I was there to foment the revolution. No, the president asked me to be ambassador at the height of the reset. This was in January, February. I was planning to go home. I was planning to go back to Stanford, like most academics do after a couple years in government. And he said, you can't leave now. We're doing all this great stuff with Russia. If you leave, the momentum will end. And then I was like, well, my family, they can't see me because I'm with you all with you guys here at the White House all the time. And so then another person at the White House had this idea, okay, you can work the Russia account, but we'll give you a new job. You can do it out in Moscow, right? So I'll telecommute in terms of my old job, and then you'll see your family and you'll play basketball with them. And that's why I became ambassador, not to foment revolution, but to continue the reset. And so the tragedy that I ended up there when I did is about the timing of what you all, not me, what you all did, not what I did. Had I become ambassador in you know, the summer of 2009, there would have been a very different reaction to me. In fact, I want to remind everybody, the president actually went to Moscow in July 2009 and did exactly what I did. You know why I know that? Because I was working for him. He met with Medvedev. He met with Putin. Then he went and met with students. Then he went and met with civil society leaders. Then he went and met with the business community. And he ended that second day with the political opposition in a roundtable. Gennady Zyuganov and Nemtsov and everybody in between. And nobody paid any attention because in 2009 it was a very different political situation inside Russia.
Thank you.
Thanks.
I don't respect that question. I didn't want to answer that question. I guess you're a good journalist.
So, Anna Viduta, former press secretary to Alexei Navalny. So my first question, where is my million? And actually, I wouldn't ask you what happened in Moscow because I was also witness to what was happening there and I can subscribe to all you said here. But I want to ask you as a National Security Council member, do you think that United States now doing an efficient job in solving this Ukrainian crisis? What can be done more? And especially on the topic of sanctions, United States is doing pretty well with it. But when it comes to European Union, which are your allies on this topic, they don't have such an integrity. And Putin is constantly working on disintegrating them and like basically making them make the different decision. And as far as I'm concerned, they have a consensus procedure. So if they're all not agreeing, there won't be the prolongation right. of sanctions. And this is kind of a very particular case for him to work on. So is United States now doing sufficient job or you would recommend something different? And if something different, then it should be a military approach or more diplomacy. So.
Yeah, it's a good question. It's part of what I would have gone on to talk about later had I didn't know I had more time. But let me tell you my view and then talk a little bit about the differences between the Europeans and the Obama administration. So basically, my view is we've pivoted to this new era. It's not exactly the Cold War, but there are similarities and differences. In fact, I'll just put up the slide while we talk so I don't through them all if I can figure it out. Therefore, if you accept that, then you have to have a brand new strategy, right? Now, my view of a brand new strategy, I came to that conclusion long before the Ukrainian crisis, just to be clear. It was in the spring of 2012, it was already clear to me that what we had tried to do with President Medvedev was not possible. And we had a pretty big, fierce debate about that, just so you know, within the government. I was advocating for what I called limited engagement, the things where it's very clear we can do it, but not try on the more ambitious stuff. And most certainly, when it's frustrating to us, stop. So missile defense, let's just stop talking to them. That was my view. Syria, let's just stop talking to them. And on democracy, we had this civil society working group that I famously or infamously chaired with Mr. Surkov. Let's just stop talking to them because we just got to not do that. But on these other pieces, and of course the biggest piece, the P5+1 negotiations, we had to keep engaging with them. That was a pretty contentious position, though, because if you do arms control, guess what? You want to do arms control with who's ever in the Kremlin. And if your job, because the president said it's your job, by the way, that focuses the mind, let's get another arms control agreement. Let's bring down the numbers below the New START levels. You want to lean into that some are still leaning into it, I should be clear. Some still think there's a window of opportunity, that might be there. I was not of that view long before Ukraine. When Ukraine happened, though, to me, it was all bets were off and we had to lean into this other way. And the essence of it, of the policy, is what I would call a kind of neo-containment strategy, right? Punish Putin when he does bad things. Deter further aggression, especially with NATO. Rebuild Ukraine. And the fourth slides, engage Russian society. And people not part of the regime, this is stronger than I would, you know, join the ideological struggle sounds too Cold War-ish, but join the kind of normative debate that Russia is heavily engaged in and we're kind of absent. And then always Kennan's most important one, avoid war. So how are they doing on this list? I'm pretty impressed by how much of my list is US policy today. You know, if you think about the first three, you can see elements of all of that the Obama administration is doing. Number four, I think we haven't even engaged. I mean, I think the argument about ideas and especially in your country, especially in the Donbass, but also in places like Hungary and Greece, that debate about us, we're losing that debate. And I think that we're out of practice. We don't think in those terms. We have this kind of this attitude that propaganda doesn't work. I have a very different view. And it's a view I did not have, by the way, before I was ambassador. My views on that have changed. So I think this is pretty good. What I worry about is two things. One is the way the administration talks about it. So the big difference, none of this Ronald Reagan did. To come back to my provocative statement earlier, did Ronald Reagan put anybody on a sanctions list? No, they didn't do that. We could argue, but I don't want to argue about Ronald Reagan. I'm going down to, I realize there's some experts, Professor Sustanovich is here. I don't want to argue about Ronald Reagan with him. He knows him better than I do. So let's leave Reagan aside. If Reagan were president, he probably would be doing all these things, but the way he would talk about it would sound very differently. And my biggest criticism of the administration, usually not the president, by the way, because he's not talking that much about this, but other members, is instead of saying, we're in this fight, we stand with you, and we know this is going to be a long struggle, they're always talking about off-ramps. They're always talking about, you know, a way to lift sanctions. They're always kind of undermining, I would say, their own policy rhetorically. And I think I would just do it differently. And then the second piece that I would criticize them on is the fourth one in my list here, where we're just not engaged. And then my biggest worry, though, is the one that you talked about, which is with the Europeans. I think the goal today for years to come is just to do what you said the policy is. To me, that would be sufficient. So, if Putin escalates, there has to be a response. I would say sometimes there is, sometimes there isn't. That's not the stated policy of the Obama administration. So just maintaining this. By the way, number three, I think, is the most critical one of them all. If Ukraine fails, giant victory for Putin, and I think that's the most contentious area right now. And then keeping the Europeans in the game, keeping the Europeans as part of this strategy, that's going to take a lot of diplomatic effort.
Could you please a little bit elaborate on number two? You haven't touched it explicitly.
Deter further aggression?
Provide military assistance to Ukraine.
Okay, that's it. Okay.
I support that. I believe that should be part of deterring further aggression.
So we're talking about
arms.
Yep, I believe that.
Спасибо. Can we just take, we have a long list. Can we just take three questions really quick? And hopefully
I'll write them down, and I'll be quicker, too, in my answers.
No,
I apologize.
No.
Yes.
No, it's been fantastic. It's been absolutely fantastic. So just very quickly.
Hi, my name is Devin Bergstein. I'm an undergraduate studying political science and Russian. Professor Vai is my advisor, actually. I have a question to build off of that. Do you think it's a concern in terms of providing military assistance to Ukraine, the nationalist militia groups that help support them in the fight against Russia? Should we be concerned about how those weapons get off? And do we have checks against the use of those weapons in that way?
Great. Okay. Tanya.
So my name is Tanya Domi. I'm a professor at Harriman. I teach on the Balkans. My question to you is, 2 days after the annexation, when Putin delivered a speech to the Duma, he evoked Kosovo, the avenging of Kosovo, six times. Very few comments or observations here in the United States or in the West. Those of us who watch the Balkans very clearly took note in February when Secretary Kerry made a formal statement about how Russia had Serbia in its sights. in November, Serbia did in fact engage in airborne operations with the Russian army. So for us, we think it's, those of us watching think it's very destabilizing, one, and two, here's where I think the Europeans have been weak and the United States has stepped back. And I'd like to just hear your views on this relationship and the dynamics now, because Russia has really picked up its presence in the Balkans and it's operating pretty much at will. Thank you.
One more and then we'll give Mike a chance to respond.
Good evening, Ambassador. My name is Buja Barish, and I am from Kosovo.
The Kosovo lobby has come.
So Kosovo, Albania is the same thing in my view anyway. But my question is George Kennan's long telegram alive and well as we speak now? Mm-hmm. And the second part is Hungary's and today's Greece is very, very warming up towards Putin. How does Washington view this situation now?
Thank you very much. And thank you for keeping it short.
All really hard questions. First on arming Ukraine, because I gave a really quick answer, so let me give a more elaborate one. I think it's a very hard issue. I don't want to be flippant about it. It's not an easy decision. The way I think about it is at the end of the day, Ukraine is a sovereign government recognized by the entire world, including Russia, by the way. They have a right to defend themselves. They have a right to try to monopolize the use of force within their territory. Those are all UN ideals that Russia itself adheres to. And therefore, they have the right to buy weapons in the pursuit of that, with the eyes wide open that there will be a response from Putin. That's clear as day to me. Of course there'll be a response. And so in the deliberations about that, if you support my view, you just talk about those scenarios, and you make sure that everybody understands that there will be a response, and there will be no escalation, the kind of Vietnam scenarios that I hear people write about. That's ridiculous. That's not in the cards whatsoever. So that needs to be articulated very clearly. And that there, the brunt of the response will be Ukraine, right? Not the United States, not the providers of arms, but the Ukrainians. So after that deliberation, if they decide that they still want the weapons, I think it's kind of hypocritical for us to say, okay, it's okay to sell the Russians weapons. I mean, the French are, it's okay for Western countries to sell the Russians weapons, but it's not okay to send Ukraine. I don't understand that. The second thing I would say, the Ukrainians, if they were, the Ukrainian government, if they were here to represent themselves, which, by the way, they always ask, maybe they will, but they always say, why doesn't anybody ever listen to our view on this? This is not just a U.S.-Russian issue. It actually, you're talking about our country. They would say they want to deter further aggression. And they would list for you the kinds of weapons, the kinds of training that would allow them to do that, that would not allow them to go on the offensive against Russia. And I actually believe them when I hear them say that they are not looking for arms to try to unite Ukraine again. That's my view. Now, there's a lot of technical military details that go into that. And I realize, the difference between offensive and defensive weapons for certain kinds of systems is in the eyes of the beholder. But I think that is something that can be worked. And I buy the proposition that it is in Ukraine's national interest to deter further Russian military activity. I also buy the argument that it's in America's national interest to deter further military operations of Russia inside Ukraine. That's my view. I know it's contentious, but at the end of the day, that's where I come down on that. On the other pieces, it's related because we just had the ambassador to NATO, the U.S. ambassador to NATO at Stanford yesterday, and we were talking about, Article 5 commitments and what has NATO done to strengthen those commitments. And of those, that's the one I feel that they've done the most on. That looks pretty good to me. I think it's highly unlikely that Putin will attack a NATO allied country. I don't assign that a high probability, but I want it to be lower. And I'm worried about it because the consequences are so detrimental to the European architecture that we want to get it to zero and not be comfortable with it being 5% or 7%. And of course, the thing I worry most about, including in the Balkans, is just this new era that I think we're in for a long time where Putin's going to be testing. He's, you know, with the aerial flights, the general Lute, Ambassador Lute said, you know, if you fly to Europe, you know, the probabilities of you looking out your window and seeing a Russian jet fighter whizzing by your civilian aircraft are going up exponentially. That he said something to that effect, right? That makes people nervous, one, about mistakes, but two, just this testing thing that they're in, including in the Balkans. It's clear that they have a test us, and then also peel off allies, you know, back to your point about sanctions. And that, to me, is where we need a kind of more fortified grand strategy that people are recommitting to symbolically, publicly. I don't know what the right way to talk about it, because that makes me nervous. And then the last thing that makes me really nervous, of course, is the ambiguous area, right? So NATO has flirted with, for instance, talking about cyber attacks might reach the threshold of an Article 5 commitment to defend against a cyber attack. But they haven't defined what the threshold is that would constitute that. So if you're Putin, you want to test that. You want to poke. You want to see. And that just, I think we need to be in a more, you know, robust, unified way to how we deal with what I think will be this testing and prodding for many years to come. And on Kennan, what was the second piece of the Kennan? The answer is yes, but with qualifications. That's just what I was talking about. Yeah, we're in that era. We're, you know, and I think it's, you know, I've only started to think about the comparisons to the Cold War era, but there's a lot more ambiguity because of the nature of the ideological dimension, right? It's not so clear cut. We've done some things to damage our reputation in Europe, right? Mr. Snowden didn't help things. The nature of the economic relationship, that's new, right? That kind of Russian presence in countries like Hungary, in Greece, that we weren't dealing with in the Cold War, and I don't think we've quite figured out what the right, you know, I think the basic response that Kennan outlined is the right one and a patient response. I don't think we've quite figured out what the new Russia means in terms of how you would do a kind of neo-containment strategy.
Great, thanks. Let's take a couple questions real quick. I guess how many we have, five people? Let's take three questions really quick, and then we'll let Mike pick and choose because we really are over time right now.
Thank you again, Ambassador McFaul. My name is Ben Rimland. I'm a senior political science student here at Columbia. And in the wake of Boris Nemtsov's assassination, there was a lot of analysis in Western media about the, sort of cropping up of, splits within President Putin's ruling coalition between the Siloviki security folks like Sergei Shoigu and the FSB, GRU, and also the various sorts of strongmen that Mr. Putin installed in Chechnya and Ingushetia in order to clamp down on the Islamic extremism there. And I was wondering if you could comment on, the sort of fracture that may or may not exist now between the security class and the Islamist strongman class.
Thanks. Great. Couple.
Hi, good evening. Thank you very much, Ambassador. My name is Prashant Dilwali. I'm originally from Boston. I'm a huge Patriots fan, so I'll get to that in a second. But my question is about personalities. And can you tell us how Putin kind of thinks about our European allies? Does he see them as a rubber stamp for U.S. policy, or does he see fissures in our relationships, and does he see an opportunity to kind of break that union?
Great.
And secondly, did he give Bob Kraft his ring back?
Being in the Kraft.
No, is the answer to that.
Just very quickly, if you could,
Okay. I'll take them all, yeah.
Okay.
How about that? I may not answer them all, but we'll take them all. How about that?
All right. Robert Hux with the Executive Intelligence Review. Ambassador, one thing I think you're leaving out of this is the fact that this is not simply Russia. Russia is part of a group called the BRICS, which I'm sure you know what it is. We just had the announcement of the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, which everybody seems to have piled into, except for the United States, Canada, and I believe Japan. And what we're looking at is, the entire financial system centered in the transatlantic. I mean, you've got Greece that's on the verge of being kicked out of the European Union, which is going to do nothing but implode the entire euro with reflections back into the United States. So the issue would be, former ambassador to Soviet Union Jack Matlock said, there's a lot of the promises that were made to Gorbachev when the Berlin Wall came down, the Soviet Union collapsed, those promises were broken.
Okay, thank you.
How do we deal with that?
Sorry,
okay,
sorry,
I got it. Yeah, that's the question.
Very good points.
Hello. Thank you for your talk. I'm an undergraduate student here, also the opinion editor at the Daily Spectator, the undergraduate paper. My question is about, Ukraine, apparent trajectory is that eventually it'll join the EU. That seems to be the idea. But you also talked about these, the retention of certain Soviet institutions and certain Soviet structures. Do you think the current Ukrainian leadership has the power to really distinguish itself, to avoid corruption, and to not fall into patterns of previous power structures, I guess? Thank you so much.
Great.
My name is Lucia Cannon. I'm alumni at Columbia. I wanted to ask you about your conclusions. And on the one hand, you said that you thought there was no cultural or historical conflict between the United States and Russia. On the other hand, you said that you thought the main reason for the sort of the current aggressive policy of Putin is the domestic challenges by the democratic opposition. So I think that if the United States stands for freedom and democracy, it basically has to support the democratic movement in Russia, and therefore it is structurally in conflict with it. So I thought it was sort of a contradiction, and you have to decide which one to give your emphasis to.
Yeah, okay. Great questions. Trying to think of which ones to skip. So on the first about the tragic assassination of Boris Nemtsov, I know the rumors. I don't know where the person went to who asked the question. So I know the rumors, and of course there are others that talk about splits within the Siloviki. And this is an intramural battle between them. I don't have any particular inside information on that. All I would say is, first of all, I think I first met Boris Nemtsov 25 years ago. It was just shocking to see that could happen. I'll tell you, because I did see him in the time when I was in government, he was more worried about these kinds of things happening than he would. He was always, in front of you here. He spoke here, right? Charismatic, bravado, always a strong person and, dismissive of these folks. But I can tell you that he worried, and his family worried, and just awful that happened. And what it says to me, aside from the personal tragedy, this is not a strong state. Come on. This is not an all-powerful regime. If I were a Russian citizen, I would be nervous about my state's capacity. After all, where it happened. And they were following him all the time. I have personal experience with that because I was with him when I worked at the White House and from time to time as ambassador, and he was constantly followed. So that this could happen, I think, is a testimony to how, I don't know what's going on. I want to be clear about that. I don't want to speculate about things I don't know, but this does not feel like a strong, effective state that's achieving its interests in this really rational, efficient way. It feels a lot more fragile to me than that. On the European allies, I would just say again, yes, I agree. It's a new era, and actually, I would throw in the BRICS on this too. It's just the cleavages in the international system are not as they're different than the Cold War. I was going to say they're not as clear. The Cold War was not as clear-cut in real time as it seems in retrospect. We just haven't quite figured it out yet in terms of how we interact. And it's contradictory. The BRICS is invoked. Russia's in the BRICS. Yeah, and they're against the United States, allegedly. But then you look at trade bilaterally for, I don't have the figures in front of me, but I'll bet bilateral trade with all the BRICS individually with the United States is much greater than it is with Russia. You know, the U.S.-China relationship for China is way more important than its relationship with Russia. I would say that about India. I'd say that about Brazil, South Africa. So what does that confab, invented here in Wall Street, by the way, not by any of those countries, what does that really say? How many of them rallied to Putin's cause to endorse the annexation of Chechnya, of Crimea? Zero. None of them. So I see more opportunity in that configuration than I think is sometimes understood. But on the contrast, I see Europe, and this gets me to the what does Putin think about them, Europe is a much more complex environment. So and so does Putin. In fact, until Crimea, Putin had, and his folks, they had a pretty interesting strategy going in terms of their soft power diplomacy. Consisted of two very different groups. The anti-imperialist coalition around the world that RT, Russia Today, kind of barks at every day, right? We're the imperial power, and they're leading the anti-imperial coalition. And then a much quieter campaign, but we were really focused on it when I was in the government, which is reaching out to social conservatives, right? Political leaders, but religious leaders, including in the United States, by the way. They had a whole campaign reaching out to evangelical leaders because Putin was positioning himself in the one campaign as the anti-imperial, the leftist standing up against the imperial America, and in this second campaign as the protector of conservative values. And by the way, that evolution in his thinking, I think, deserves more attention for those of you looking for honors theses to write about, because it's striking to me his relationship with the church, his thinking about his own mortality, that social conservatism. If you look about like who his friends are today, they all have that kind of view, and the economic liberals that used to hang out with him 15 years ago, They're not watching the Olympic Games with him anymore. That's interesting. His move into Ukraine has complicated both of those campaigns, right? So it's hard to say you're anti-imperial when you're acting imperial. And the big winner of that, of course, are the Chinese, because they still play that card, and so they're the big winners in that campaign. The second one, however, is more nuanced. I think with the evangelicals in America, they have really shut down their kind of track two diplomacy, as we would call it, between the churches for political reasons. Europe seems a little more complex to me. And that most certainly is something that Putin is going to try to exploit for the rest of his time in power. And, he believes that the Europeans are weak. Somebody asked me, what do you think about it? He's very dismissive of Europeans. He thinks they all care about money. They're all kind of fat and happy. They don't understand real power. This is an argument that some American writers have made about the Europeans in earlier eras. And he thinks that he has the right toolkit to peel off just enough of them to help make the coalition fall apart. Finally, on the last question about culture versus the Democrats, and it's a hard question that I don't want to. I probably came off too definitive. I have to say this, and this is a good place to end. So, I had a colleague at Stanford. His name was Marty Lipset. And Marty wrote a very famous article in 1959, in the APSR, by the way, American Political Science Review, about modernization theory. His basic argument there was the more well-to-do a society is, the more likely it is to become democratic. And over time, we used to always kid around with Marty. Marty's always right in the long, long run. He's always right about the long run. He was even right about Germany in the 20th century, right? In the long run, Marty was right. Modernization helped and democratization. But the interregnums, of course, were these dangerous periods that Marty kind of skipped over. And I kind of think about Russia in the long run in the similar terms. I just met too many young, interesting, educated, well-connected people when I was ambassador to think that when they're, some of them are here right now. It's just hard for me to imagine that this regime we see in place right now, the one that would lead to the assassination of Nemtsov and these things, how will that, what's the more outrageous proposition? That regime will be around in 30 or 50 years, or that something will replace it. I think the more outrageous proposition is that it'll be around in 30 or 50 years. And I do think this gets back to your question about my original writing. We're still in the last fumes of the Soviet system and Soviet people. But that will not be true in 20 years' time or 50 years' time. In fact, I remember a very senior Russian government official who always wanted to convince me that this was a necessary transition. This Putin era was necessary to get to that world, that Marty Lipset world. He described that we needed a strong man to get us through it. And Mike, you just got to be patient with him. And he's doing the right thing. He's constrained a little bit in what he knows. But he wants to get there. It just needs this period. And we would debate this often when I was ambassador. And then one day I went and saw him. And he said, Mike, you'll never believe what I just did last night. And I thought about some really nasty thing. Tell me. He said, I took my daughter to a Lady Gaga concert. And he said, have you ever been to one of those? I said, no, I haven't. I've met Lady Gaga, it turns out, but I'd never been to a concert. He said, this was crazy. He said, I saw a Russia. This is a very sophisticated senior person. I have never saw that side of Russia. 12-year-old screaming kids. He said, they'll never put up with the shit that I put up with. That's what he said. He just, and to me, that's the Marty Lipset story. And I know there's the nationalists will take over, and beware, there's another argument that the same group of people make to me. Beware, Mike, what you wish for, because if Putin falters, the fascists will come in. And maybe, I don't exclude the possibility that there may be a period like that in Russia's history in the future. I hope not. But in the long run, I'm incredibly optimistic about Russia's future. I just don't know when that long run begins. Thank you.
Thank you. I want to thank everybody. I want to thank everybody for coming for a really terrific set of questions. I want to thank again the Harriman family for their support. And I also want to thank Mike for being very patient. And Mike often said that he was not a career diplomat and that he never learned diplomat speak. And I think we're all very glad for that, for such a frank, personal, and engaging talk. So please join me in thanking him once again. Thank you.